Welcome. Come on in. We're friendly. We don't bite hard. Hi. So then we also talk about durable work gloves, because when you're working with glues and stuff like that, then you want to have durable work gloves covering your hands. Well, I've gotten more than one hot glue gun burn, and I think I actually have one right now. I'm sporting one really hot one, super blistery and lovely. And, you know, plastic gloves or latex or non-latex alternative gloves for when you're painting or dyeing with Sharpies, just because you don't want to look like your wig or be the color of your wig. I mean, unless that's what you're into. And then newspapers or garbage bags, because while wig work isn't as intensive as armor making, it can make a mess. And I know that if you're living with your parents or your significant other who's not as big on dyeing everything in your house, then you're going to want newspapers and garbage bags. Work in a well-ventilated area, well-covered, and with permission if needed. There are some tech spaces that will allow you to work on wigs in them, but again, it's a universal space, so you want to be universally respectful. But yeah, so safety first. So what I'm going to go into is the general supplies you need and tools that you need to work on wigs. A foam head is usually preferable to an actual human head. And or another head-shaped object. I have seen people use melons. I have seen people use styrofoam balls. I've seen people use a little bit of everything. And you also want to make sure, if you need to, with styrofoam heads, some of them tend to run kind of small. So if you need to pad it up or anything like that, you might want to get upholstery foam or something to that effect, especially if you're doing like hair that's pulled up in the back or something like that, so it's not too tight on your head. Sewing pins to hold your wig in place on your foam object or melon, whatever you're using. And upholstery needles and thread. They're curved, so they're just a little easier to get into tight spaces when you're doing wig work. But you can use a hand needle, but the curved upholstery needles are a little bit easier to use. A wig brush, which is very different from a normal hairbrush. A wig brush is made with like anti-static bristles. So what happens is, instead of brushing your hair and getting frizzy, it allows you to brush the wig and it won't react with the fibers of the wig. Scissors and offset scissors. So scissors are just your run-of-the-mill scissors. Offset scissors are those ones that are like razor bladed, so it doesn't look all like you've blunt cut it, like you put a bowl on your head and you've just taken scissors. And then hot glue gun with multi-temp glue. I used it a lot for creating shapes that I'm not too worried if they're going to sit in a car, a hot car or something like that. Come on in. We're super friendly. We're doing a panel right now. It's super awesome. Thanks for asking. Don't you think she looks good in this hat? Okay. Okay. And then tacky glue or waterproof glue. Now, the reason I never recommend wood glue or things of that nature is because they're water soluble. So if you end up wanting to do a shoot in a pool, or if you're ending up in the rain, you're going to be a fat wig. And then temporary. Oh, well, you can also use, with tacky glue, you can also use silicone housing caulk. That's actually what I used to do my rose quartz curls, is I coated the hair and then I wrapped them around toilet paper rolls to get them curls. For temporary, you can use hair clips and elastic bands to hold your hair in place. And for very simple styling supplies, so if you have pigtails or something to that effect. For wigs that you're looking to wash or reuse frequently, these temporary versions of putting them up or putting them together are useful, because if you're reusing the wig for another character, you can just wash and wear it. Got to be glued products. Everybody kind of sings the praises of these. They are biodegradable, though, so you will need to restyle your wig if you're planning to keep it like a Sasuke wig. You want to have it spiked up for a long period of time. If you haven't washed it in a while, it's going to start getting a white residue, which is, oh, so fabulous. And you'll want to take a hairdryer to it, and that should help clear up some of that. Otherwise, it's best just to wash it and restyle it, because if you haven't washed it a while and it's gotten that white coloring, it's usually because it's gross. Definitely always practice good hygiene with your wigs. So Spiking gel, pomade, and freezing spray are all three versions of products that are sold by Got to Be Glue, Got to Be products, and they're very good for styling wigs. They can be on the expensive side, but they're the better quality ones for your money. And then fabric softener. Now, if you end up with a wig that looks like this, like you could have party lights under it and have a disco, then you're probably going to want to use a little bit of fabric softener. If you soak a wig in fabric softener, it helps to soften the fibers and make them look not so shiny. Come on in. It's okay. Okay, that's fine. Or maybe they're coming from the pool. So those are all objects you can use to start, like, your basic wig work. Then going into advanced things, you can use a shaving razor to get razor edges. You can use a a box cutter to get the foam if you're building forms underneath your wig, like a lot of anime, like, wig hairlines and stuff like that are... It's okay. Very gravity-defying, to put it politely. And so you can create shapes with foam or fabric or things like that. Curling tools, you don't usually want to use... Hi, come on in! You don't usually want to use any actual heat or ceramic tools. You usually want to actually use curlers or plastic forms, or you can even use like toilet paper rolls or round shapes. Hi, sweetie, come on in. Oh, we're getting everybody now. Okay, I guess I can start. Mind if I start? We're going to just restart because there are new people and I don't want everybody to feel lost. Okay, so we're going to just, we're only like three slides in. We're fine. Here we go. So welcome. My name's Kat. I've gone by the name Ichigogami for a very long time, since I was about 7 years old, and I've been cosplaying since about then, too. I'm 27 now, so it's been a long time. But I teach costuming on the regular. That's my human job. And so I am happy to bring this information to you today on how to style wigs or how to work with wigs. So if you're wanting to do basic costumes or you're wanting to up that level of cosplay, these are some hints and tips and tools that you can use. And if you have any questions throughout the panel, please let me know. I tend to ramble, so I will see a hand and I'm happy to answer your question. So, supplies and tools. You'll notice throughout my panel, I'm usually very focused. Stop healing Pokemon. Stop it. You'll notice throughout my panels that I tend to talk about safety. And the reasons why are people tend to get unneeded injuries from not practicing proper safety when you're dealing with things like Sharpie markers or glues or things that are very sensitive, especially if you're very sensitive to chemicals or you have allergies and things like that. It's good to practice safe practices when you're dealing with, you know, handling chemical glues and things of that nature. So it's always important to have things like work clothes, clothing that you can get damaged or dyed and it doesn't matter. You want to use a ventilation mask for whatever you're working with. If you're working with paint or you're working with inorganic vapors, you want to make sure you have something. Even the disposable ones are better than having nothing because we all love our lungs and we want to have them live as long as we do. Then durable work gloves. Now, this can range because if you're using a hot glue gun, you're probably going to be more prone to using things like leather gloves or gloves that are going to protect your fingers, because right now I'm sporting a pretty awesome hot glue gun burn because I did not put on my work gloves. Or in the case that you're doing dyeing or painting, you'll probably want to use plastic gloves. Welcome! Come on in, have a seat. And then because we usually will work in kind of universal spaces, we do have to share. And some people don't appreciate that dye stain on their couch or, you know, their cabinets. So it's always nice to have newspaper and garbage bags to cover the space to make sure it's well covered so that you aren't staining, marring, or otherwise causing destruction to the space itself. Important. It's always important to work in a well-ventilated area. If you're working with specific kinds of glues and stuff, it's always good to have a buddy, so in case you black out, they can call 911 for you. And in a well-covered space. Yeah, go ahead. A lot of times, as long as you have a bunch of windows or a room with a lot of windows and you have some, you can put like an AC fan, a revolving fan, like a box fan in the window and it'll help ventilate the area. If you still are unable to find a well-ventilated area, try and look in your local area for tech shops and studios that allow you to do those kind of creative works, because there are different artist studios as well as DC and Arlington have a tech shop. And then I know that there's another one not too far off. I want to say it's in Maryland, but I know there's one for sure in Arlington, and they usually have a lot of Universal spaces. Another thing you can do is set yourself up a box outside. So if you're worried about something getting wet, you can have a cardboard or wood box that you do all of your work in outside, so you're not inherently outside. Or if you have a garage, you know, you can set up a temporary that tear down space. And those are all just different options. So if you are still unsure of where to find a well-ventilated space, I will do my best to help you out afterwards. But did that give you a good idea of things to look for? Okay, cool. All right, so safety first, because I'm all about safety. Okay, so for supplies and tools. So for your basic tools and skills and stuff like that, you usually want to have your lovely foam head. It's preferable to a human head. And you want to have another head-shaped object. I've seen friends of mine use melons. I've seen friends of mine use styrofoam balls. I've seen friends of mine use different things. But it's preferable to have something you can pin into with the sewing pins, which is another thing. Usually the ballpoint head pins, the ones that have the big colored plastic tips, are the best because you can usually find them within your wig and you won't get stabbed in the head by accidentally leaving one in. And then upholstery needles. So upholstery needles are a little bit different from a traditional hand needle. They're curved, so they can go around tight spaces a little bit more easily. So if you're working on sewing in different parts of your wig or stuff like that. And then a wig brush, which is a little bit different from a traditional hairbrush. It is made with anti-static and anti-cling fibers, so it does less damage to your wig than a traditional hairbrush does. Scissors and offset scissors. They're kind of, you know, straightforward. It's scissors. Offset scissors are the ones that have the teeth and look like they're kind of a little extra sharp, or and they basically, instead of creating a cut that looks like you just put a bowl on your head and you have a straight line, they help to make it look more natural. Offset scissors, they're a little bit different. They're actually a hair supply. So pinking shears are a type of scissor. I would never ever use them on a wig. Yeah, they do have the zigzag, but they're not very good for wig fibers. They're not going to cut as easily as the offset scissors. The offset scissors are actually made with an extra sharp edge to cut through hair. Pinking shears, they're not going to do much damage to a wig. The wig's going to take them out. Hot glue gun and multi-temp glue is good for a lot of styling of wigs or pieces that are smaller. If you're going into bigger pieces like drill curls for like video game characters and stuff like that, you're going to want to use like a tacky glue or waterproof glue, so a silicone housing caulk or things of that nature that will coat the hair, and then you can wrap it around a shaping object. For temporary styles that you're going to wash and reuse the wig, you're going to want to use things that are like gel or hair clips and elastic bands. A lot of people swear by got to be glued products or got to be products that people know. The freezing spray, which is the thing that looks like an air horn can. A lot of people like that, the spiking gel and the pomade. The downside with those products is they are biodegradable. So after a while, your wig's going to turn a funky shade of white or have white particles on it, because if you haven't washed it, which is rank, always wash your wigs. Then they get a little funky, so you can fix that by hair drying it, but that doesn't always get rid of that particulate, so it's good just to practice good hygiene with your wigs. Just wash your wigs if they're wash and wear wigs. And then fabric softener. So if you have this kind of wig that looks like a disco ball, you can soak it in fabric softener, and it's the fibers are going to get a little bit softer. They're not going to be as reflective. So for advanced... And this is for if you're wanting to get that anti-gravity look to your hair. Bird mom. Then you're going to want like a shaving razor, a box cutter for cutting foam and other objects to shape the wig. Your curling tools, which I didn't say curling iron because you never ever want to use a ceramic or a heat-based object on your wigs because they're not real hair. They're not going to take it very well unless you're using human hair, which we'll get into that later. Because it is they're very temperature sensitive. If you get them above a certain temperature, human hair can handle a lot more abuse. Plastic hair cannot. So you want to use things like curlers or like the plastic shapes, or I've even used toilet paper rolls depending on what kind of shape you're trying to get and what size of the curl you want. I know. It's for wigs. It's all good. No, the wigs. Do you think she cares? She doesn't care. I could slice her. She'd be fine. Now with paint and stuff like that, it is a little bit hinky because you don't want to paint a wig usually because it just coats the fibers rather than does anything to change the color. But for things like Death the Kid, where he's got a definite white stripe, sometimes it can work. Silicone caulk, which is what it's a glue that I was talking about earlier. It's traditionally used in home repair for sealing off all the molding around your shower and stuff, but it's useful for creating bigger than life pieces. And then E6000. So I did talk about this a little bit earlier, but E6000 is a very dangerous chemical glue. A lot of people in the dance industry have a lot of problems with it because the vapors are fat soluble. So what happens is those vapors, if you're not using a ventilation mask, can actually get into your fat cells. And then when you go to work out or something, you can actually get really ill. So practice safety around E6000. It's a rubber-based glue. It's got some petroleum in it, which is always so delicious. And so it's always good to practice safety and be in a well-ventilated area. And then silicone coating spray. So silicone coating spray is traditionally a lubricant, but it can work on your wigs. You want to make sure that the one you get is like food grade or something that's safe to be near your skin. The ones that are auto are not recommended because they're for a car. And then sewing machine thread, which is what you use to sew wefts and things like that in, and heat sealer. So a heat sealer is what you can use if you don't want to sew in your wefts to your wig. You can just pop some of the wig filling in and then just heat seal it. It's used a lot on when people get like plastic dreads or extensions put in. They use the heat sealer to like block off the hair. And then hairlines. So I know a lot of you probably, when you're wearing a wig and stuff, you want a convincing looking hairline. You want the wig to actually look like it's your hair and not like it is some ratchet mess that you've got on top of your head. Well, you can create a fake hairline that'll attach to your skin with attaching netting to the front of the wig or to parts where you add, you shape the hairline. You can also use extension clips to help. If it's got a pretty defined hairline, these are little hair clips, and what they do is they actually affix pretty firmly to my hair itself, so the wig's not going to slide around. And combs. And, yeah. Oh, I actually use a wig cap, and have you ever seen those? They're like a big round hair comb, but they're kind of zigzaggy. And they stretch out. They're like way from the 90s, like if you remember the Spice Girls. Like, so I use that first, and then I put my wig cap over. And it holds my wig in place. Because if you don't have a good fit on your wig, you get what we call wig rash, which is where you can get like a big dent in your forehead. Some people get abrasions and blisters and stuff, which is not good, and it's not comfortable, and it usually means that your wig is a bad fit, and you shouldn't be wearing it. Because it can actually cause permanent damage to your skin. It can cause dermatitis and all that nasty stuff, especially if you don't wash your wig, because that's just gross. But yeah, so when you're dealing with your wig cap, if you've got long hair, I have friends of mine who have hair down to here, and they'll wear wigs, and they braid their hair, and they wrap it like a snail around their head, and then they put the wig cap over that. It does make it a little bit bigger, but wigs kind of naturally hide it because the shape of the wig, as long as you have a good wig, okay? There are some wigs that the wig cap is just going to show through no matter what you do because the quality of the wig isn't there. But if you get a good wig, it's not going to show a lot of these parts in here because it's got all of these wefts sewn together in it. And I have a few supply lists on the end for you, so if you want to look for a good wig website, I can hook you up with that. For structural, if you're wanting to build big hair like Sephiroth from Final Fantasy or any crazy anime anti-gravity defying hair, you can use fabric, you can use tape, you can use hanger wire, foam core board, or styrofoam. Now, foam core board and styrofoam, they are a little hinky because they're not all environmentally like stable. Like over time, they're going to degrade. So you'll want to just make sure you're upkeeping the wig really well. And then for dye supplies, because I know when you've got a wig that you're wanting to change the color of, you can use spray paint bottles or spray bottles, the squirter bottles, and then paint brushes, towels, and plastic bags. And those are all really good tools for when you're starting to dye a wig. And we're going to go into for dyeing, as I lay dyeing. Sharpie and alcohol method is the most proponent method. Like, it's the most talked about method to dye a wig. It's basically you're mixing 100% alcohol with ink. And what happens is it's such a pervasive, like, chemical that it actually can sink into the fibers of the wig and stay there. And it's very messy, and it'll dye your hands. So again, you want to always use those gloves because you don't want to be the same color as your wig. But it is the most permanent method because you can always go back and dye it a darker color or tint it a deeper shade. It's just all about the ratio of colors you mix together. And then whenever you're dyeing a wig, if you're not sure how it's going to affect the wig, always do what we call a swatch test, which is a test of a small amount of hair in a not distinguishable location. Because if you're trying to dye a wig and it's not, never ever try to dye something too black, just buy a black wig, honestly. But if you're ever trying to dye something a darker color and you're not sure of the ratio you need to mix, maybe you need it more blue or more green or more purple, whatever, then you want to make sure that you've gotten the right ratio of dyes first before you go whole hog and you've dyed the whole wig and then you cry. So then you've got artificial fiber dyes. So I know you guys, if you've ever done tie-dye as a kid, you know Rit and Dylon, those are some big companies that do a lot of production of powder dyes or liquid dyes. I don't usually recommend them because they're not always guaranteed with your wig. Because even though they're made for polyester or blended fabric fibers, your wig isn't always receptive to the dye, and it might not turn out the way you think it will. So again, swatch test. Dyes that coat rather than, invade the fibers. They just coat the fiber. So if you wash the wig two or three times, it's gonna flake. It's gonna look chalky and weird. So you usually would only use these for rare instances where you just maybe need a temporary fix. Acrylic ink and alcohol or acrylic paint and water. A lot of times these are not very permanent or they're very temporary. And what they do is they just coat the fiber instead of basically making it a permanent color. You always want to test. And when you're dyeing a wig, it can cause pigment to bleed. So if you're afraid of it bleeding on your costume, test wear it first with like a white shirt or a tank top and just see how much it does bleed. And if it bleeds too much, then you might need to start again. Don't let a lack of foresight stain a costume, because when you're working on a costume and a wig, it's a lot of your time that you've spent on it. So just be careful. So wig type materials. And I want to explain, because even though she looks bright, she's not cheap. And even though he looks like he's a natural hair color, he's one of my cheaper wigs. So it doesn't always mean that a bright color means that it's a cheap wig. It's all about fiber and fiber types and things like that. So when you're looking at the low end, I know some of you probably know about Party City and Halloween cosplay wigs and all those lovely things that are coming up, because the season is here. The season is nigh. Halloween is coming. So those are the Walmart wigs. They're artificial fiber. They usually don't determine what the fiber type is, which raises kind of many flags for me. They're usually a spun plastic or listed as unknown fiber. The unknown. They're usually super, super shiny. Like you could have a disco party with these kind of wigs because they're just really bright and they look bad in photos and they're just not very friendly. If you're starting out, you know, they're great wigs. They're, you know, if you've got to have a wig for the weekend and you're like, oh my gosh, I didn't leave myself enough time. Oh gosh. Sometimes you're able to redeem them by soaking them in fabric softener, but other times there's no such luck. They're usually low usage, like one or two uses, and they'll start to fall apart. And they're usually really heat sensitive. So if you try to go and style it in any way with a hairdryer or try to curl it with like boiling water method, then it's not going to quite take. And then mid-range to high-end wigs are going to be heat-resistant fibers. That's usually what they're going to be listed as. Sometimes they're also listed as Kanekalon, Tokyokalon, Elora, which is a newer fiber type, and then Hyperlon. They're all basically lawns. The lawn family. They are heat-resistant, and they'll take most styling, and they're usually what you'll see when you look at Ardo wigs or high quality cosplay wigs because they tend to be reasonably priced for good quality fiber. So that's what we tend to go with. And they take dyeing systems well and they take a lot of styling and forms and stuff like that really well. They're not super unfortunate to style and they actually can be repaired if you take proper care of them. Not recommended. These are also impractically expensive. Human hair wigs. So, pros. They're human hair. So, you can usually treat them as such. They're reactive to treatments like real hair. They take dye really well, like hair dye, because they're real hair. They're great quality fibers, because they're usually hand-laid and fancy. They're usually made for people who don't have their hair, so they need hair to wear to look like they have hair. That's okay, because there are people who go through alopecia and cancer and things like that. Human hair wigs, great for them. Great. But they're expensive. Think upwards. Let's think. Okay, so what do you think an expensive wig is like? They're usually upwards of $100 a pop. Now, considering I paid $12 for this wig, and I think like 10 for this one, and maybe like 5 or 7 for this one. That's a lot for a weave, okay? I'm not looking to go on the beach and be Baywatch blonde. No, no, no. I like my pink hair, and I'll keep it that way. It can be really, really expensive, and it can be in a very big, you know, budget buster. So if you're looking to make that costume on a budget, it's probably not going to be your friend to get a human hair wig. They're also, like human hair, sensitive to overprocessing. So when you go to bleach your hair, if you bleach it too much, you fry your hair. If you put too much conditioner in your hair, it gets greasy. So like a human hair wig is going to react the same way. It's honestly the brand because different companies license their name out to actual manufacturers. And then those manufacturers produce the product. So there might be a year that Leg Avenue, let's say, they're making their Sailor Moon costumes and they make a really awesome wig and you're just like, oh my gosh, this Sailor Moon wig beats all other Sailor Moon wigs to the party. And then the next year, you recommend that wig to all your friends and they buy the wig and they're like, this fiber is shinier than a new penny. Yeah. They license their name for like 3 to 5 years and then, you know, they do whatever. They find factories that can make it cheaper, you know? So, yeah.
Crapshoot.
Unfortunately. But the websites that I'm going to recommend you guys to are the ones that are my tried and true and the ones I go to all the time. So, wigs. When you're dealing with wigs, it is always good to determine what the style is. If you need to go with a darker base, like a black and then sew in things, or go with a lighter base and dye it an ombre or add different pieces. And if you need to attach wefts, like attach separate pieces of hair or attachments, or create color. So dye the wig, paint the wig, whatever you decide to do. If you want to splice a wig, which basically means taking whole parts of a wig, doing like lobotomy, and joining two wigs together in any variation, it could be split up the half, you know, if you're doing Monokuma from the Danganronpa series. And then, of course, attachments and clip-ins, like my Sailor Moon, Sailor Jupiter wig. She got a ponytail that clips in. And y'all can come up after the panel and come up and look at my lovely little menagerie. And those will usually come in ponytail style, where they clip on, or pigtails. They'll come as buns, sometimes with Sailor Moon wigs or certain characters. They'll come as wefts, which just are like extensions that you can clip in the back or in the side. They'll come as bangs or, again, extensions. So wigs are not hair. If I were to cut it a little too short, this is about the look she's going to give me every single time. I could make the biggest mistake on the wig and be the saddest person in the world and be like, oh my God, I messed this up. This is her look. She is nonplussed. Wig hair don't care. So it's if you accidentally cut it wrong, it's a learning experience, you know. You might be able to salvage the wig for a future project, but don't take it to heart. It is all learning. We all learn. We are learning. We are students of life. But to avoid that, planning out your project is the best thing you can do. And then also documenting your process. So get yourself a notebook. Get yourself an app. Get yourself a little Word document on your Windows 97, whatever you have. And just draw it out. Design it. Sketch it in a sketchbook. Put it on the computer. Gather as many references to your character as you can. Front view, back view, side view. We all love the back view of Tracer, don't we? And so the character too, like who are they? What is their hair made of? Maybe you can get away with making the wig out of fake fur. Maybe it's they're an action character, so they need spiky hair, so they're gonna need a more coarse fiber versus a character who's got luxurious mane and they need silkier fiber. And then hair color. Is it dependent on the fabric colors? Is it something where it's a video game character and she's got so many alternate. This is my Ramona wig from Scott Pilgrim, if any of you know that series. This is her video game version. First player, second player, her hair is pink. Third player, her hair is green. So obviously, the character's hair is determined by the costume I chose. And then structure. How is it going to attach? Will it need to break down for packing? Are you going to be going to Anime Expo or Dragon Con with a big-ass wig? Well, then you're going to need to break it down. You're going to need to figure out how many pieces, what you're going to do with it. Are you going to ship it? Are you going to pack it in your luggage? Is it pop up, tear down, piece apart? And then how big is it? How big is your hair? How big is your wig? Is it a beehive like Marge Simpson? Is it a boy cut like any Bishonen series ever? Does it have crazy forms like Peridot from Steven Universe? Does it have a crazy hairline? All of these you take into account. When you're building the execution, I know this is a lot of information, guys, I know. You can set up a temporary workspace. So it's either temporary or permanent. My workspace is permanent, but that's just because I do this on a daily basis. I work with professional theaters, I work with students. So I usually have a permanent space. You can also have a convertible workspace. Maybe you have a box you set up in your yard to work on your wigs. Or maybe you have a little area in your office that you set apart for your cosplay work. You can set up your wig head. You can just have a simple foam set up. You can take a Coca-Cola bottle, and if you want something to counterbalance, maybe you've got a really big wig you're working on, you just pop this head on the bottom. That's okay. On the bottle, because they just... And it is like a really great, you know, slightly longer wig setup. You can use like a PVC pipe or a pole base to put it on. And that'll keep it, you know, adjustable. So if you have to do multiple styles... you can prep your pieces. it's better to go in assembly. So you're going to put your setup on your wig head. You're going to have your workspace. And then you're going to prep any pieces you need to add. So if you need to dye your wig, if you have attachments that you have to shape or, you know, cover or put fabric on, then you're going to want to do all that work. And then you're going to separate your wig into parts if you have to curl it or if you have to style it, because you want to make sure you've got everything portioned out in a good, organized way. And then you're going to attach pieces. So the stub method is where you would take a wig, and if it was longer fiber, you know, I'd wrap this in a rubber band, and then I'd finish it off with glue or something. And well, I'd cut it off. I'd finish it off with glue. I'd take the rubber band off. And then if I had to attach a bun because I wanted a more permanent look than a clip-in, or if I wanted to attach a ponytail because I'm doing a big I Dream of Jeannie head thing, then you do the stub method. And then if you have to sew in extra wefts, you want to do that. Or if you have to attach foam or other applications to your wig, then you're going to do it at that point. You also want to make sure throughout the process you do continuous fittings, because I made the mistake of not, and I totally ruined a wig because it was an updo, and I did the stubbing method, and the stubbing method is permanent. So once you do the stubbing method, you're kind of SOL. So I had done all the sewing and this work on this wig, and I couldn't wear it because it's too small for my head. So they are so much smaller. Like, my brain doesn't fit in here, guys. So make sure to do fittings throughout the process. Always remember to document your process, and the best way to learn is through your own experience. I can sit here and tell you all day about everything about wigs. I know you're so excited to hear and see and everything. I know, I just see the excitement in the room. It's invigorating. The best way to learn is through experience, and practice makes perfect. If you're unsure of how it will affect the wig, always test first on a small swatch or on some extra wefts you have, and or in a place on the wig it's not going to show, and where to go. So these are all the reference sites. You can take pictures with your phone if you need to come up and write them up later or whatever like that. I'm going to be writing up a handout for my website soon, so hopefully that'll be. So there's Arda Wigs, which everybody knows about. Arda, Arda, Arda. Wig-supplier.com is the one I go to. All the wigs that I usually buy from them, and the fibers are usually top-notch, and it's inexpensive. I mean, they're based in Hong Kong, so they're right off the factory, you know, floor or whatever, so it's probably why it's so cheap. And it takes, like, 2 weeks for the wigs to come in, but that's, you know, pretty reasonable. And I've cross-bought from eBay versus wig supplier, and even with shipping, I know their shipping looks heinous. It's like $30 for, like, 7 wigs or whatever, but it honestly was cheaper than when I tried to buy the same bulk from eBay. So you could shop around, but I've done it, and that's my experience. Amphigory is good if you've got some really strange wigs. I needed a mohawk ponytail wig, and they had it, so Amphigory's got a lot of funky ones. I know, they are. Isn't it crazy? I know. Oh, my God. And they have such a 90s website. It looks like JavaScript just, like, vomited all over the place, okay? And then Doctored Locks, which is, like, they're an alternative hair site, so they'll also have, like, dreads and wefts and curls and stuff. So Doctored Locks is pretty cool. Petting Zoo Wigs. Oh, yeah, please. Oh, like FX? And Wigs. I would say there are a few websites that you can get FX from, but not a lot of them also sell wigs. I'm thinking the only one that I can think of right now is Vampire Fangs. There, I know. They sell colored contact lenses, and I think they sell wigs, but they also sell, like, fangs and FX stuff. You can look for special effects on Amazon. Amazon also sells wigs, but that would be the most helpful website I can imagine. Then, of course, Etsy and eBay. Cosplay.com is a website where you can look for resources on cosplaying if you've never done that before. If you're new, there are literally thousands is comfortable. I'm comfortable with that number. Of tutorials on how to do wig work, on weapons, on how to sew cosplay together. There are tutorials on specific costumes and specific wigs and props. Cosplay.com is super awesome. Styling help and tutorials. Cosplay.com has a lot of really great ones on their forums. You can actually look for their wig forum. YouTube, obviously, it's YouTube. Arda has some really great basics. Katie Bear, who is Petting Zoo Wigs up there, has a whole book she legitimately wrote on wig styling. Doctored Locks has a few tips and hints. Cosplay Tutorials is a website you can look up that has some wig help. And Epic Cosplay, who is also a wig vendor, they also have some help on there. Yeah. And then this is me, so if you want to get in touch with me any future instances or anything like that, and that's... I remedied the situation of not having a card. So if you have any questions or you want to come up and meet me, I don't bite, and you can come touch my wigs. I know that sounds really weird. I'm sorry. But yeah, it's been fun. Thank you.